What's up guys, this is Mohammed, and in this video I'm going to show you the settings you need to set to get the best possible image from the Panasonic G9. So go ahead and put the camera in the movie mode. This is how you can get the settings pertaining to shooting videos. Go ahead and go into the menus here, and in the second tab, here's where you have all the settings related to the quality of the video that you're going to shoot. So first and foremost, put your rec format to MOV. This is how you get the 10-bit files from G9. Under rig quality is where you have all the different resolutions, frame rates, and bit rates. For the best possible quality, use the 4K 10-bit 422 long GOP at 150 megabits per second option. Now go down to photo style. This is where you would choose the Vlog picture profile if you have the Vlog upgrade for the G9. But if not, I use the Cine-like D option with the noise reduction set at -5 and saturation set at -5 as well. The reason why I don't bring down the contrast is it doesn't give you any extra dynamic range. It just raises the shadows and gives you more noise, and that is not true dynamic range. So I leave contrast at 0 and sharpness at 0 as well. Sometimes I like to bring sharpness down to -2, but nothing lower than that. So next option is luminance level. And if you're shooting in Vlog, you'll be forced into 0 to 1023 by default. So I just leave it at that. You know, with this, you capture all of the luminance levels and then you can change that in post if you need to. So coming down to slide 2 is where you have highlight and shadow. I leave these at 0. I never touch them. Artificially bringing up the shadows or bringing down the highlights is not something I want to do. Next up is eye dynamic and eye resolution, and I always have these off. Eye dynamic basically just raises up the shadows and gives you more noise as a result. Again, this is not true dynamic range. This doesn't change how the sensor performs. So you're not getting any extra dynamic range by enabling this setting. So I always leave it off. And eye resolution just adds in-camera sharpening to the file. That's not something I want. The idea is you want the footage as raw as possible. You don't want any effects to be, you know, applied in camera. That way, when you bring that raw file to your editing program, you can do whatever you want with it. And if you're not satisfied, you can always undo the changes. But if you do turn on these and have these effects in camera, you can never go back and get that raw file again. It's like shooting in black and white versus doing it in post through color correction. So if you change your mind and you want the files to be in color, you can always go back and have it in color. But if you've shot in black and white, then there's no going back. All right, so coming down to stabilizer, here we have two settings, E-stabilization and eyes lock. Now, I'm not a big fan of E-stabilization. It kind of adds that warpy effect to the videos. But IS lock is a hidden gem. Basically, it makes your shot look like it was shot on a tripod. So here's some examples. This is at 150 millimeters equivalent, handheld without the stabilization of the sensor. So there's no stabilization in the lens or in the body of the camera. Now here it is with the IBIS turned on. This is just the internal image stabilization system of the G9. And here it is with IS lock. And look at that footage. It looks like it's on a tripod. It's not moving, there's no shake, there's nothing. And this is the Sigma 50-100, which is a very, very heavy lens. So this is a really, really impressive and awesome feature that the Panasonic cameras have. So coming down one slide, you have the X-teleconversion. What X-teleconversion does is it crops in by 1.4 times. So basically it goes from super sampling the entire width of the camera to capture the 4K footage into a pixel by pixel footage, basically cropping down to 8 megapixels, but still giving you 4K at its native resolution. This is a really awesome feature because it gives you basically two focal lengths to work with. One is the base focal length of the lens, and then the other is the 1.4 times crop. For example, if you have a 50, if you turn this feature on, you'll have a 70 millimeter equivalent field of view. Digital zoom is the opposite. It doesn't keep the true resolution in 4K, it digitally zooms in. So you lose detail and resolution if you use digital zoom. So I prefer to never use it. Next up is timestamp record. And if you have it on, it basically adds the date and time to your footage. Let me turn the mic level display off so you can see it. Here in the corner, it says the date and the time. Then you have mic level display, which I always have on. Next up is mic level adjustment. And I always have my internal mics set to -12 dB. This is because I use external recorders like the Zoom H6 or external microphones, and those have much better preamps than cameras do. So the idea is to lower the preamps in the camera so as to have a lower bass level noise and then increase the gain either on the external recorder or the external microphone. That way you have a much better sounding and much cleaner audio. Next up is mic level limiter, and this basically prevents any audio clippings. So for us who shoot a lot of weddings, there's always loud music in the wedding. So this prevents the camera from clipping the audio. So coming down to the last tab is the sound output. So basically, real time is anything you hear is being transferred to the headphones in real time. Rec sound, however, is what the camera is recording, the audio that the camera is recording. And where you're monitoring the audio with headphones on, this can be real distorting because there is like a 1 second or 2 second delay. So come down to the wrench with the C icon and go into the monitor and display options. Here you have your zebra pattern options for checking your exposure. And what's really cool about it is you can set each zebra to be at whatever percent you want. So I have mine set at 80% and 100%. So 80%, the highlights will be close to blowing out, and 100% means I have completely lost my highlights. So on tab 5, you have your focus peaking options. And it's cool because you can actually change the color of the focus peaking dots. And then you have your histogram, which you can turn on and put it anywhere in the display, which you can use to carefully monitor your exposure. And it's very cool that Panasonic has implemented this histogram feature in the Panasonic G9. So for setting your white balance, the G9 has a dedicated white balance button at the top here. And here we have three auto white balance settings: auto white balance cool, and auto white balance warm, and a bunch of different settings for different environments. And then you have two sets of four custom white balance options. The first four are set by pointing the camera at a white balance card or a gray card, or by just pointing the camera at a white wall. And then the next four, you can actually set the white balance manually. So if I don't have my white balance card with me, usually what I like to do is I like to put it at 6,000 Kelvin for outdoors, you know, in the daylight. And then for indoors, I set it at 4,000. Now, of course, these, you know, the 4,000 Kelvin for indoors and 6,000 Kelvin for outdoors are rough starting points. And I like to fine tune my white balance based on skin tones and such afterwards. But in a pinch, these two values will not let you down. So now that you know all these different and complicated settings that the G9 has, I hope you can get out there and shoot some wonderful footage. So that's it for this video, guys. I hope you liked it and found it informative. Please leave a like on this video. Let us know what you think in the comments. Subscribe to my channel and go back and watch all my other videos. Till next time.